T-Ray the Violinist.
Unmute, Mr. Dennis.
Wow, sorry about that. I just was so blown away by that musical presentation from T-Ray. That was fantastic. Good evening, folks. Welcome. And thank you for joining us at the our second virtual guest chef night. Thank you so much to T-Ray the Violinist. For those of you who don't know, T-Ray has been an amazing friend to Liberty's Kitchen for several years, providing music for our annual gala, Come Grow With Us, and being on the planning committee for the event, where he also helped secure some really incredible auction items like a wine tasting and an exercise classes. I mean, the man is connected. Not only that, but he's also a real man of service and a man of many talents, and I want to give him a chance to let everybody know what he's up to these days. So T-Ray, tell us what's going on in your world.
All right. Thank you, Dennis. Good evening, everyone. Thank you for the opportunity to take a couple of seconds to speak to the community. Currently, I have an initiative benefit campaign going that's entitled Music for Meals. And the purpose behind this benefit campaign was to provide meals for essential workers, essential healthcare workers, other essential workers, and also families in the communities that have been deeply affected by COVID-19 and haven't been able to provide the proper nutritional resources for their families. So I believe Mayor is going to drop a link in the chat if anyone would like further information about it. We're going to run a campaign for a few more days for anyone who's on the guest chef tonight this evening that would like to inquire about how they can donate and how they can be a part of this initiative. And also you can just hit me up and ask any questions if you have any. So thank you, Dennis. I'm excited about this evening. Thank you, Liberty's Kitchen. And I'll shoot it right back to you.
Thank you, T-Ray. As most of you know, we had to suspend our on-site training in mid-March and immediately went to case management work. A big part of that was making sure we kept in touch with our trainees and graduates and ensuring that we could help to meet their most immediate needs. And for a lot of them, that most immediate need was access to fresh food. With the help of our partners, the program team members have been able to deliver grocery boxes to on average 20 young people per week. Our partner in service, Top Box Foods, which provided the grocery boxes we're all cooking out of tonight, has really ramped up their offerings and made that possible. Connor Deloach, Top Box's executive director, is here to share more. So Connor, why don't you tell us a little bit more about Top Box?
Yeah, thanks so much, Dennis. And it's great to see everybody for another virtual guest chef night. So Top Box Foods, for those of you who aren't too familiar right now, we are a community-based organization that is focused on building equity around food. And to give you the short version of how we do that, we essentially try to cut out all of the middlemen, all the pieces in the supply chain that go from a producer to your table. So we're essentially trying to connect people as closely as possible to their food. Sometimes that takes the form of us using really large distributors and doing really bulk purchases so that we can really deliver, you know, that base price and save people a lot of money on food. But other times, and more recently, what we've been able to do is partner directly with local growers so that we're literally getting food directly from the farm to your table. And that's what we've been able to do for you tonight. So a number of the items that you'll see in the box that we delivered to you came directly from one of our close partners, Indian Springs, which is a farm we work closely with. So items like the bell pepper, the onion, the Creole tomato, the garlic are all items that have been grown locally and sourced locally for your pleasure tonight. I'm not gonna go away without saying one quick thing about our dear friends at Liberty's Kitchen. Everything that Top Box is able to do has always been supported and essentially brought to you by Liberty's Kitchen. We are our own organization, but we owe everything that we are able to accomplish in the food sector to Liberty's Kitchen, and we are very grateful to have a place in their building and at their table. So thank you to Liberty's Kitchen, and I look forward to a phenomenal guest chef night.
Well, Connor, thank you for those kind words, and we mean this. You guys mean the same to us. Just thank you for everything that you've done, and the reason why we love being partnered with you guys, because we think that what you're doing is so incredible and the work that you lead is incredible. And happy to have you in the building, happy to be partnered with you, and happy to have you tonight. I, for one, am really excited about this guest chef night dinner. Some of you might know about the pieces of our work, food access, leadership development, our piloted bar program, but not quite understand maybe how they all work together. We're hoping, you know, that's okay. We're hoping that after tonight, you get a better understanding of how we all work together, especially now, when working together really means a lot. Without further ado, I'd like to introduce our guest chef of the evening. Tonight, we have Chef Alfred Singleton of Cafe Sbisa. Chef Alfred has been a longtime supporter of Liberty's Kitchen, and we have been eagerly awaiting a time when he will be able to host his own guest chef night. Chef Albert was one of three chefs who in 2018 participated in a farm-to-table dinner that really showcased just how well he works as a teacher and a mentor to young people. At this dinner, Chef was paired with a young man in our program who was lucky enough to learn the art of sous vide cooking and duck à l'orange. You'll hear more from Chef in a few, and thank you for being here, Chef. We are really honored to have you in our corner and to have you as a mentor to young people in our network. Thank you for being here this evening. Syrena Johnson. Syrena is a graduate from Liberty's Kitchen and one of my favorite students and just one of my favorite people. Syrena graduated from Liberty's Kitchen and went on to earn a scholarship at the culinary school in New York, has cooked all over the world, and has gone on to actually win Chopped. That's right, you heard me, win Chopped, the television series. Before returning home to New Orleans and mentoring other young people who are coming up in this industry. She's currently a trainer at Job Corps, and I'm always so happy to see her, but I'm really just happy to see her this evening and glad that she could free up her incredibly busy schedule to host tonight's event for us. So thank you so much, Syrena, for being here.
Anytime, anytime.
I also want to send a big, big thank you to Touré folks for the cocktail creation and demonstration that we are all going to get to enjoy this evening. Touré is the program director of Turning Tables, Liberty's Kitchen's bar service training program. Touré will talk more about his experience with Turning Tables, but for now, again, I just really want to thank Touré for his involvement in the work that we do here and tonight, being part of tonight's event. Each of the folks you see here tonight, T-Ray, Chef Syrena, Chef Alfred, Touré, are all leaders in their own fields, from culinary to music, education to the art of the drink. We at Liberty Kitchen know that it is vitally important that we are able to expose the people who come to this program in order for them to be leaders into fields. They need to be reflective of people who look like them. Can't stress that enough. We have a similar background to them, who are bold examples of what can happen when you work hard to achieve your goals. And finally, as always, I have to thank you, our supporters near and far. We cannot do this work without you. Thank you again for being there for us in the past and now. All right, I think I've spoken enough. I don't know about you guys, but I'm already ready to cook. So, Chef, take it away.
How's everyone doing? I'm Chef Alfred Singleton. I'm the chef and owner of Cafe Sbisa in the French Quarter, 1011 Decatur Street. So excited to be here today to host this guest virtual chef night, something that's a little bit different than I'm used to, but we're going to work our way through. We're going to have a lot of fun. We got some exciting and very, very, very great local ingredients for you from the people from Top Box Farms, and we're excited. So let's have fun. Let's have fun. We're gonna do a lot of great things. It's gonna be a little bit different. We're gonna have fun. Make sure we stay entertained. We're gonna be full. We're gonna eat. We're gonna enjoy ourselves. So we gotta get our prep and our mise en place ready. Mise en place, just making sure we have everything in place. Once we get everything in place, we're gonna head over to the stove and we're gonna get things rolling. So I'm excited. We're gonna get it rolling. Let's get ready. All right, so what we're serving today, we have ribeye steaks that we got from the people at Top Box Farms. We wanted to make sure that everything that we got was local ingredients, right? So these are local ribeyes, that we have. They're about 8 ounces, they're a little bit thin, so we're going to cook them rather quickly, right? We're going to sear them on both sides. We're going to season them well. We're going to sear them. We're going to baste them with just a little bit of rosemary and garlic and butter. We're going to let them rest while we make the other ingredients for the dish. All right, we're doing a corn mock shoe with Louisiana corn. We have some corn here, and we also have some beautiful Creole tomatoes. Right now, we're in the month of June. Creole tomatoes are very, very plentiful in the Southeast region. Very, very sweet tomatoes, real, real good. We have some local peppers. We have some onions that we're going to julienne, and we also have some cremini mushrooms. We're gonna demonstrate how to clean the corn, julienne onions, and also deal with the cremini mushrooms. So if anyone's not familiar with the process, we can go ahead and get you familiar with that. So we're not doing anything that you're unfamiliar with. So we also have the rosemary chopped up. We have some crumbled goat cheese we're gonna finish with, which is gonna add a nice sweet note, real creamy note to it. And we're gonna use some heavy cream and butter as well in these dishes. So make sure you have your heavy cream and butter prepared and ready. We're using salt, we're using cracked black pepper, and we're also using Creole spices to season with everything. When we're cooking Creole dishes, we're cooking in Southeast Louisiana, flavor is everything. So we wanna make sure that we have these Creole seasonings available. We're gonna use some salt and pepper, but Creole seasoning is what's gonna give our dish what we're looking for as far as the flavor and the seasoning profile is concerned. And also, just a few a little bit of parsley and green onion. We're gonna add some to the mock shoe, and we're gonna garnish with a little bit of that as well. So we're ready. So corn mock shoe is a Creole dish. It's a Creole and American Indian dish. It's stewed corn. A lot of people might associate corn mock shoe with fried corn. But you know, it's traditionally made, you'll render some bacon and you'll have the fat from the bacon and you'll saute all your ingredients in the bacon and kind of finish it that way. But this version, we're not gonna render bacon. I had bacon this morning, so I can't have any more bacon tonight. So we're not gonna use bacon. So Doc, if you're looking. So we're just gonna saute these ingredients with a little bit of oil, a little bit of, you know, we're gonna add the ingredients to them, saute them, get everything going, the onions, the peppers, the tomatoes, the corn. We're gonna add a little bit of cream to it, some salt, pepper, and Creole spices, and kind of let that come together. We don't wanna over cream it because we still want it to have some texture on the plate. So so that's gonna be the corn mock shoe. And then we also have these cremini mushrooms that we're gonna finish the dish with. We were going to use oyster mushrooms, but they weren't available, so we're doing cremini mushrooms, which is still a good mushroom. It's a little bit different. These are a native of the European and North American grasslands in their immature state, right? In a mature state, you might know these mushrooms as portobello mushrooms. So in an immature state, these are creminis, also in the button mushroom family. If you see the lighter mushrooms, the white mushrooms, those are the regular button mushrooms, but then they have this brownish tint on them. Those are cremini mushrooms. So as they continue to mature, they become portobello mushrooms, the bigger mushrooms that we're probably familiar with seeing. So we're just gonna slice these real, real thin. We're just gonna pop the caps out of them, off the bottom. We're gonna take the stems out, just like such, right? And we're just gonna discard the stems. We don't need those. If you like the stems, you can leave the stems on. But I find them to be a little bit woodsy and a little bit chewy. So I like to take those out. And you just grab a knife and just slice them real, real thin. You can use a chef knife, you can use a serrated knife, whatever you prefer, whatever you're comfortable with. And we're just gonna slice those extremely thin, okay? Not you know, too thick. We want them to cook. Yeah. So once they're sliced, they're gonna begin to look just like such, right? Once they're sliced, they're gonna be nice and thin. So when we saute these mushrooms, we're gonna get the right texture, the right consistency that we're looking for in these mushrooms, okay? Also, we have julienne onions, right? So we talked about, you know, that process and talking about the process of slicing those onions. So julienne onions are just thin strips of onion. The way that I like to julienne my onions, after the onion is clean, I'll take the onion and I cut it in half, right? And then you'll come up with something that looks similar to this, right? The stem side and the root side are both off, right? So then you just turn it this way and you just begin to slice it rather thin. So thin strips. All right, so once you get that, you just kind of break those apart and you come out with a nice julienne onion, okay? And those are going to also go into our corn mock shoe. We don't want to cut them too thick just because we want them to cook. We want them to, we don't want to have too much onion bite in our corn mock shoe, okay?
Chef, while you're going, I want to ask you a question since I'm here, just in case anybody else are curious. Tell me how you kind of got your start to even have to be an owner of your own restaurant. How did you get started in this whole, from a younger chef perspective to a veteran in the game? How did you get your start and how did you become an owner of your own spot in the French Quarter at that?
A lot of sleepless nights. I was fortunate enough. I've been in the culinary industry, in the restaurant industry professionally for over 22, 23 years now. And I've had the opportunity to work with some of the best chefs in the city. I've had the opportunity to travel the world cooking and do a lot of different things in this industry. But the thing that really helped me was being able to sit and watch behind some of the great chefs in the city, working with the Mike Udos of the world, the Haley Gables of the world, the Alan Heckwisses of the world. I also worked with the Adolfo Garcias of the world. So I've had an opportunity to work with some great chefs in this city. But I've been cooking since I was a kid. My family owned a small sandwich shop in the Lower Ninth Ward when I was a kid, and I was always in the kitchen. Of course, I love to eat. Of course, you can probably see that. I was just always in the kitchen trying to figure out what was going on. And my mom used to go out of town, and I was a chef at home. So by the time I was about a sophomore in high school, I just really, really, really wanted to get into the restaurant industry professionally. And my first professional restaurant job was working at Maque, which was the Ralph Brennan restaurant. I did that for a few years and found my way into the kitchen. And I've been in it ever since. I've been fortunate enough to, you know, work with some of the greatest chefs, work at some of the best restaurants in the city. I was a chef for Dickie Brennan and Company for 9.5 years. And, you know, I polished and refined my craft after that. And then, you know, in 2016, my partner, Craig Napoli, I reached out to Craig Napoli and was like, hey, man, listen, let's get Sbisa rolling again. It had been up and down since Hurricane Katrina, and we got into it and renovated, you know, retweaked it and got it back to where it needed to be, and we opened. So it's exciting to be, it's different. You know, it's a blessing to be from the city of New Orleans and, you know, be a chef and owner inside of the French Quarter in my city. You know, that really motivates me and keeps me going every single day. So I'm just excited to be there and excited to do some great things and excited to partner with Liberty's Kitchen as well.
How did you even hear about Liberty's Kitchen to want to even be a part of what they had going on?
Well, I've being from this city, I really take a liking to you know, helping and mentoring the youth that's trying to come up in this business and in this industry. It's extremely hard and challenging for young folk to get into this industry and do what we do every single day. And I want them to see a figure such as myself and use my platform to let them know that, look, anything is possible. I'm from the same city that you're from. I grew up in the same streets that you grew up in. They were probably a little bit tougher when I came up, and I made it out by being positive and focusing and working hard to achieve what I wanted to achieve. So Liberty's Kitchen was you know, we kind of got together. Some people reached out to me, and we did a dinner for the turning tables, the former table dinner. We did that dinner, and you know, we just been going ever since. So I'm extremely proud to be a part of Liberty's Kitchen and what they offer and what they're doing with the youth here. Okay, so I have an ear of corn right here, one ear of corn. And we need to clean this corn, right? If you receive this in your box, the corn was fresh from the garden, all right? fresh from the garden. So what we want to do is just take and peel that corn, and you're going to see those little hairs on it. So we'll bring it all the way down, okay? And this is going to pop that piece off, right? Now, as you can see, it's not fully clean. There's a lot of hairs left on this corn. So what you can do is just take a kitchen towel or a clean towel. Don't take a dish towel, a clean towel, okay? Get a clean towel when you take and you just take and just wipe it just like such. And those hairs are going to get trapped in the towel. And you can just dry those off into your trash. Okay? And what's going to happen is you're going to come out with something that looks just like this. Now, how do I get this off here? I don't know. All right, we're going to show you. So you take a vessel, you can use a plate, a pan, whatever you have available. And what I like to do is I like to just sit it right in the center, just like such, okay? And I'll take a serrated knife. And what I mean by serrated is you see this knife, it has a lot, some teeth on it, okay? It has some teeth across the bottom of it. And I'll use a serrated knife, but you can use whatever you have. You don't have to use a serrated knife, okay? So, and what I'll do is I'll just go into the corn and I'll just go straight down. And that's gonna land right on that plate. If you don't do it on a plate or another a pan or something like such, what's gonna happen is your corn is gonna run all over the place, okay? And you're gonna have a mess on your hand. I don't wanna be at your house when that happens. All right. So you just take that off just like such. And then you have a clean, all you have left is the cob, right? So you're gonna get rid of that. And then you just take that corn, you can just break those up and just make little kernels of corn, okay? Those are gonna be nice and sweet, ready to eat. That rhyme, listen to me. I'm a poet, y'all. All right.
For everybody nice who's watching, if anybody's out there watching have a question, hit the chat box up. We're watching it. We're answering questions. And, yeah, we're rolling. Chef, did you make your own Creole blend for the folks out there? Is it like a secret recipe? Can we get, like, on it?
No. We don't do secrets.
Okay.
We want you to be able to make everything exactly the way I do it, okay? So all we use was salt. We did some fresh cracked black pepper. I wanted to crack it fresh and do a coarse brown blend versus just using fine pepper. But if you don't have that, it's okay. The finer the granules are, the more potent it's gonna be, right? So you don't want it to be extremely spicy. So we did and we're doing steak. So when you're doing steak, you wanna use a coarse brown, a coarse pepper, or butcher's grind is what it's called. It's a butcher's grind pepper. Or if you go to the store, it might say a restaurant style, a restaurant blend. Black pepper, and it's gonna be nice and coarse ground. So we freshen the ground that, and this is just the Cajun seasoning. You can use whatever you like. You know, if you wanna use a Zatarain's or Tony Satchery's or Slap Your Mama, or if Mama, if you're watching, I ain't talking about you, all right? But this is just a Creole blend. If you wanna make your own, you can do that. A little bit of garlic, a little bit of onion powder, some paprika, and it's usually gonna be a high ratio of salt. So. And you can make your own blend and some black pepper as well. So we just used what we had available in here and also ground up our own black pepper, okay? So what I did with the steaks, ladies and gentlemen, these are the ribeyes. They came in, and I just took them out of the packs.
Chef, we have a question. They say, if I forgot my seasoning, can I use crystal sauce to help spice it up?
If you forgot your seasoning, your Creole seasoning?
We're gonna
put the Creole seasoning on a steak. You can use just salt and pepper on a steak if you don't have Creole seasoning. Inside of the corn Maque Choux, if you don't have Creole seasonings, you can use your crystal hot sauce for that. We don't want to put crystal hot sauce on the steaks just because that won't work out too good for us. Okay. So just a little bit of the ribeyes. I have them on some towels here just so they can drain some of that protein liquid. That's on them, or as some people might call it, blood. But we want to make sure that these are nice and dry when they go inside a pan. Now, these are thin steaks, okay? So it's going to cook rather quickly. I like my steaks to be about medium rare to medium. So these are going to cook rather quickly. If you personally like your steaks cooked a little bit more, I would advise you to preheat your oven to about 350 degrees, okay? So once we sear them, you can finish those in the oven while we get the rest of the ingredients together. Okay, so that's that. So we're just gonna, I'm gonna season those at the stove when we're getting ready to go, because I don't want, obviously salt draws out moisture. I don't want more moisture to come out of them once they go into the pan. So we're dealing with a gray steak or a cold pan. We wanna make sure we get a nice caramelization on the steak, a nice char on the steak, and we'll be great, all right? So we're gonna use a universal sign here. I know as chefs, we tend to move a little bit quick, so I'm gonna try to make sure that everybody's on the same page with me, so I'm not moving too fast, so you're not far behind or lost trying to figure out where we are. So we're just gonna do a quick thumbs up. Syrena, keep us on track with the thumbs up, if you will, okay? So quick thumbs up. Once we thumbs up, if everybody's ready, we're going to move to the next step, and we're going to get that going. So all the mise en place is in place. Everything's ready to go. We're ready to move to the stove and begin cooking. And after that, you know what time it is. We're going to eat.
Chef, what's your take on, like, marinating steak? How do you feel about that?
I'm sorry?
What's your take on, like, marinating steak? How do you?
If that's what you prefer, usually if I'm going to grill a steak, I marinate it. But if I'm going to cook a steak just like this with on the stove, seared, you know, again, if you marinate, you're going to add moisture and more liquid to it, right? So if you're grilling it, that's fine. But if you're on the stove, you're searing, you know, when you're doing steaks, you really want to taste the steak. You want the flavor of the steak to be there. So once you marinate, you get a lot of the flavor from the marinade, right? If you're searing, you're going to taste the meat. And what we're doing is we're preparing a complete dish. So this is a complete bistro dish where everything's going to be on the plate right there. So if you're barbecuing, you can marinate your steaks. But like this, I really prefer you just to season with salt, pepper, a little bit of Creole seasoning, or maybe using some garlic and onion powder. I mean, salt, pepper, and garlic powder, or SPG is what they call it in other places.
All right. I like what I'm seeing. I'm seeing families cooking together. That's awesome. Teaching them young. That's how it goes.
So right now I have a couple of different pans. I bought some of my favorite pans with me. When you're dealing with steak, you want to use, when you're searing steak, you want to use maybe a cast iron or a heavy French saute skillet. All right, so that's what I have here. It's real, real heavy. And once we get this extremely hot, we'll get the consistency and the caramelization that we want on our steaks. Once we finish with the steaks, I want you to have another plate or vessel prepared. We're going to take the steaks out of this pan. We're going to put those steaks onto a plate to allow them to rest, right? Once the steak is hot coming out of the pan, it has a lot of pressure built up inside of it. So if we begin to cut that before allowing it to rest, all of the juices and flavors is going to run out of that product. So we want to make sure that we have another vessel to catch those steaks once they come out of the skillet. I gotta grab a couple more items off the table.
If anybody has any questions, wondering anything, like I said, I got my eyes on a chat screen, so let us know so we can help you out. Don't get stuck at home trying to, you know, watch him and then miss something. If you got a question, hit us up. We'll answer it.
We tend to flip our dishes. You know, we get our pans and we got the magic flip, you know, making magic, flipping things all over the place. Listen, if you're not familiar with how to do that, get a spoon and we want you to use your wrist game with the spoon instead of trying to flip that. I don't want the mock shoe to be all over your kitchen, all right? So I have my pan getting hot for my steaks. And I'm gonna put that it's been getting hot, so I'm gonna turn that up extremely high. And also, you gotta have the fresh rosemary that I asked you to put spoons for me, babe. The fresh rosemary, just a little bit that's not has not been chopped up, and just a little bit of garlic, which I have right here that's still kind of whole, and then some butter. Once we sear the steaks, we're gonna put that into the pan and allow that butter to baste. With that rosemary and garlic to baste those ribeyes for us, okay? All right. Also, make sure you have the heavy cream available. We're going to cream your mock shoe like we talked about. And we're going to go from there. All right. So we're going to start going. So what I'm going to do now is, hold up. Everybody ready?
Chef, we have a question. Someone says, should we bake the steak first?
Should we do what? No, please no. Listen, if you like the steak well done, then you can probably, you know, put it in the oven a little bit, and you know, not very long. These are very thin steaks, so I wouldn't do that. They're going to cook very, very quickly, and get to consistency as we would like. If you like your steak medium rare, you're going to follow along with me. If you like it cooked a little bit more, like I mentioned, once we sear the steaks, you can put it into a 350-degree oven until we're ready to serve or begin to present the plates as we are going to do. Okay? So the first thing I want to do is I want to sear these steaks. Okay? I had this pan getting extremely hot. Might be a little bit too hot, but I like it like that. All right? So I'm going to slide this one over. And I have a little bit of olive oil blend. Please do not use extra virgin olive oil when you're cooking anything, when you saute it, because extra virgin olive oil, again, has a very, very low smoke point, okay? So what's going to happen is if you use extra virgin olive oil, you're going to have smoke all over the place. But right now is a great time if you have some exhaust at your house, some vents, cut those vents off, make sure you get them high, because, you know, with this high heat and the fat from these steaks, you want to kind of get a little bit of, you want to get a little bit of smoke all over the place.
And olive oil has a very distinctive taste. I don't like to cook it, use it in every. Olive oil is more of a finishing oil.
Very, 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 very true. And also great for salad dressings.
Yep. Right,
so now what I want to do is I want to begin to season these steaks. We want to do a liberal seasoning. When you're dealing with steaks, you season in the outside of the steak. But also if you got a thick cut of meat, you want to make sure you get enough seasoning to kind of get through that entire steak, okay? So we just want to season liberally. With a little bit of salt, don't get afraid. We're gonna season the other side once it's in the pan. Just a little bit of salt.
Chef, what kind is that? Kosher salt?
That's just kosher salt. Very okay. Kosher salt. If you don't have kosher salt, you can use iodized salt, whatever you like. Sea salt, whatever works. A little bit of fresh cracked black pepper. All right, this is coarse ground black pepper. So we can see those flecks of that pepper in the steak. Don't be afraid to season. And then just a little bit of that Creole seasoning, right? So put a little bit on that. Just like such, right? Do like the salt man. All right.
Let's do that again.
What, you want to do the salt man?
Yeah.
All right. So we got that out of the way. The pan is nice and hot, ladies and gentlemen. We're gonna put a little bit of oil. Let me get my handy dandy tongs. I got those prepared and ready. Right, just a little bit of oil. You see how hot that is? That is smoking up. Now, these are real thin, so they might curl up on us just a little bit, but that's going to be okay because we're going to slice these once we begin to present. All right? That's very, very hot. Give it that very quickly. Now.
Chef, we have a question. Do you rub the seasoning into your steaks or no? That's what, from what? Kyle. He said into.
I don't want to rub the seasoning in it because I want the season to be there. You can rub it if you like, but if you rub it in, you're going to rub it all off.
Right.
So we season that liberally, just like such. All right. Sit down for me. I notice I have my handy dandy resting vessel. Ready to catch my steaks once they come off the fire. Now, please do yourself a favor. Whenever you're cooking anything or you saute it, make sure you give it time to cook. A lot of times we get extremely impatient. You see a lot of people that's shaking the pans. Shaking the pans or moving things around. You won't get the caramelization that you're looking for if you continue to mess with the pan, okay? So just give it a little bit of time to do what it needs to do and then flip it over and go from there. So this is going to allow us to go about 2 minutes on this side. We're going to flip it and allow it to go about another 2 minutes on that side because it's a nice thin steak, as I mentioned. And then we're going to put it off and allow it to rest, okay?
What's the best temperature to have?
I like my steaks to be medium rare or medium. But I, depending on the one, the steak that I'm eating. If I'm eating a ribeye, I prefer those to be medium. A filet, I would definitely want that to be medium rare.
You
want to
talk about Terrace Major?
Oh. So we were going to have Terrace Major. Terrace Major, we flipped our steaks, okay, by the way, and you can see the caramelization that we achieved on those steaks, all right? So at this point, I'm going to put some butter into this pan, right? Because in the pan, let that butter melt.
How much butter?
Just about 2 tablespoons of butter, some rosemary, and then that piece of garlic, right? And what's going to happen here, we can turn our fire off at this point if you're taking your steak at medium rare. And what's going to happen at this point, that rosemary and garlic are going to begin to caramelize just a little bit, right? And look at my tongs. I have my hand in the spoon right here. All right, and we're going to take that, and we're just going to begin to baste that a little bit. And that's going to have all that nice rosemary and garlic flavor on that steak, from that steak.
So it's sort of like you infusing a butter with the herb and the garlic.
Exactly. Okay, now, again, because these steaks are so thin, I want to take these off the fire at this point because I want my steak to be a nice medium rare steak, okay? We're going to allow that to rest.
Chef, someone has said, explain the rosemary again, how we was talking about we left it whole and not chopped, and we put the whole garlic in there because we want to infuse that butter with those, with that garlic and the herb. We don't need to chop it because we don't need to get it lost in the butter and stuff. So we leave it, we leave whole for when we're basting, just to kind of get that stuff all infused. If you chopped it up, it'll probably be all over the place, and rosemary is a very pungent herb, so you don't want to have it all over the place. So keeping it whole will kind of keep it intact and infuse the butter while it's in the pan.
It's the exact same pan that we just finished cooking our steaks in. As you can see, we call this love inside of a restaurant. This is love that's inside of this pan. A lot of love inside of this pan.
What you gonna do with that?
Those mushrooms that we're gonna cook, those creamy mushrooms that we have, we're gonna cook right inside of this pan, okay? So what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna add some garlic to it, just to toast that just a little bit. So we're gonna add about 1 tablespoon of mint garlic that you should already have ready when you need to fly. We want to toast that very, very quickly. We don't want it to burn. We just want to toast it to let the oils and the aromatic come out, okay? We're going to add a little bit of chopped rosemary back into this pan. Love rosemary. Give it a nice effervescence. Love that. And then we're going to add these cremini mushrooms. So we just want to do enough for about 2 people, maybe about a cup or half a cup, depending on how your appetite is. But they're gonna cook down just a little bit, okay? And just begin to saute those. And I'm gonna add just a little bit more, about another tablespoon of butter into this pan.
Everybody, don't trip. Touré is coming to demo this drink. So don't drink it all. I've been waiting patiently with my drink on the side, but Touré is coming to demonstrate, do a little demo on this beautiful cocktail that we got from Turning Tables. So stay tuned for that.
All right. So, as you can see, the mushrooms are beginning to come together, okay? They're beginning to saute very, very good. So what I want to do now is, because we're using these mushrooms, they're a little bit different than what we originally planned, I just want to add just a little bit of heavy cream to them, just to kind of cream these up just a little bit. Not much, just a little bit. A little bit of heavy cream, a little bit of parsley is going to go into these mushrooms. Yeah, that's about a quarter cup of heavy cream that I put inside of there. Kind of bring it together. As you can see, these mushrooms, that cream is beginning to cream up quite a bit inside of the pan. Those mushrooms look phenomenal. Look at them. Wow. Oh, yeah, baby. Oh, yeah, baby.
So, Chef, how you going to use those mushrooms? Is it going to be like a salsa?
It's going to be a topping right on top of my steak, right?
Okay.
When you get it on the plate, you'll love it. You're going to add a little bit of salt to it and a little bit of pepper. We're seasoning that at the end because we can always add more seasoning. We can't take seasoning out. And mushrooms act like a sponge, right? So what they do is they absorb a lot. We don't want to put too much into them early, and then it absorbs all that salt, and we're stuck with some salty mushrooms. So these are done, ladies and gentlemen. The mushrooms are prepared, ready. We're going to put those off to the side and let those sit until we're ready to plate up. Okay. Now, we have any questions? Anybody have any questions? Are you ready to go?
Yep, we ready to go.
Thumbs up. Everybody good? Let me know now. If I need to slow down, let me know.
All everybody, right. We don't have no questions. I think we good to go.
So now we want to do, what we're going to do is, we're going to do the Corn Maque Choux, right? As I stated before, Corn Maque Choux is an American and Creole dish, American Indian and Creole dish. It's stewed corn or fried corn, traditionally made with lard or bacon fat. We're not going to do that. We're going to use a lot of oil. We're going to cook this up a little bit different. You're going to love the way this looks. You're going to see it and really, really, really enjoy what we have here. As far as the Corn Maque Choux is concerned. Now, you should have about a half a cup of heavy cream left or prepared ready, and probably about another 2 tablespoons of butter ready for this dish to come together. All right, so what we wanna do, we wanna start, make sure we got a hot, nice hot pan. Let that get a little bit hotter for us. So here you should have your corn prepared, your Creole tomato should be diced up, your bell pepper should be diced up. You should have some minced garlic, some parsley and green onions, of course the julienne onions, and of course the corn, and some heavy cream and a little bit of butter. Those are the ingredients that we're gonna use, or the mise en place that we're gonna use for making our Corn Maque Choux. Now, mise en place, as you can look and see, if you look at what I have here, this is my mise en place. Everything is in place, right? So I don't have to run to get this or run to get that. When you're in the kitchen, mainly when you're working in restaurants, you want to make sure that you have everything in place so that you can cook and get your dishes done. You can focus on your entrees and focus on the product that you're preparing so that you don't have to take your eyes off and worry about it burning or worry about something happening, you know, the stove catching on fire or something like that. So have everything in place so you can be at the stove preparing what you need to prepare. So this pan is nice and hot. So again, we want to start with olive oil. Whenever we're sauteing anything, we got about 2 tablespoons of olive oil inside of the pan. Whenever you're sauteing anything, sauteing means just to cook real fast on high heat. We want to start with that process. We're going to start out, like I mentioned before, we want to toast the garlic just a little bit, okay, just to get the aromatics out of it. We're going to add the bell peppers to it. We're going to add the bell peppers first. As you can see, this pan is hot, so this is going to help us to cool this pan down just a little bit before we put that garlic into the pan, okay? Watch the flame. It might get a little flame, and that's the fun part. All right, so we got about a half a cup of bell pepper and just a little bit of garlic that we're going to drop in there, about 1-2 tablespoons of garlic, depending on how much garlic you like. There you go. You got flame. You got flame.
Thanks for the theatrics.
All right. So these are green bell peppers. That was what's available. Tri-colored bell peppers are green as well. You can use an orange bell pepper, a red bell pepper, a yellow bell pepper, whatever you prefer. It's all going to give it that same flavor. Maybe it's a little bit more sweetness with those others. Okay. I added about a half a cup of julienne onion to this pan as well. Right. One might ask, well, why you add everything different? Everything has a different cooking time. Everything has a different texture. Some things cook a lot faster than others. So what we want to do is make sure that everything gets cooked the proper way, okay? Now we're going to add the corn. That's enough about 2, guys. That's about a cup of corn, right? And again, if you can't do that magic flip, now
just about to say, chef, don't try it if you can't. Like if you ain't a pro, your whole.
But I don't want your mom Q to be all over your kitchen. I'm gonna have to come to your house and make some up. All right, now we got that. We're gonna add the Creole tomatoes. Now what I did was I diced the Creole tomatoes up, but I left them just a little bit nice and thick, right? So I can, you know, just get that in there. I don't want them to break down too much. I'm gonna add all of those tomatoes because I just love tomatoes. All right, I'm gonna add all of that to it. At this point, I'm gonna begin to season the Corn Maque Choux. Okay, so don't overdo it. Black pepper, right? Creole seasoning.
Can you repeat it?
Salt, black pepper, Creole seasoning. To taste, whatever your taste buds desire. There's no actual measurement. When you're dealing with salt and pepper in a restaurant, in a lot of recipes, you'll see salt and pepper to taste. Based on your taste and how you feel about it, that's how you want to make sure that you do.
So if you got high blood pressure, please don't put that much salt. Nice.
At this point, ladies and gentlemen, we're going to add some parsley, green onions, and we're going to add the cream to it. Okay. So green onions, I can be liberal with those. I love green onions. Parsley. It's going to give a nice color to our corn mock shoe. Okay. Everybody on? All right. So you notice how that is looking. That's beginning to look extremely good. Just make sure yours look like that in the pan. Now we want to add the cream to it. You smell it? Oh, man. Y'all got smell of vision? Got smell of vision? Oh, man. That's smelling great. All right. So listen. We want to add about a half a cup of cream to this. Don't want to overdo it. Right? About a half a cup of cream, and we want to allow that to reduce. It's a little bit that's going to come together.
Whoa.
Someone asked, would now be the right time to add hot sauce or after the
Yes, cream? Yes, right now, yes. If you don't have Creole seasoning, go ahead and add that crystal hot sauce or Tabasco or whatever you like. Don't add too much, all right? Mainly crystal hot sauce because it has a real, real potent flavor. It's real, real full body. I would prefer you to use Tabasco, but not as much of that because that's more vinegar, right? So just use a little bit, maybe about, you know, one teaspoon or so of that hot sauce. We're tossing that. That's looking beautiful. We're going to let that continue to reduce a little bit. Once we come back, it's time to eat. Well, we're going to plate first, then we're going to eat.
Chef, they was just asking, can you go through corn machu again?
Yeah.
Just run it through the steps right quick for them.
So corn machu, we started out, we added the peppers and garlic to the pan just to let those begin to saute just a little bit. We added the julienne onions to the pan to let those cook a little bit. Then we follow that with the corn, add the corn to the pan, and then the Creole tomatoes, some parsley and green onions, a little bit of salt, pepper, Creole seasonings, add the heavy cream to it, and then parsley and green onions to it. And we're gonna add a little bit of butter to it just to cream it up at the end. In Creole cooking, there's heavy emphasis on cream and butter. So when you go to a lot of Creole restaurants, say, man, why don't I have any cream sauce? Well, Creole restaurant.
After Chef is complete with this, we're going right over to Touré with the drink. So y'all be ready to down this right here. Chef, can you tell us the importance of why you just didn't add everything in the pot and why you staged it and did things step by step?
Well, as mentioned before, you stage them because all ingredients have different cooking cooking times, right? Some ingredients have different textures, right? Tomatoes will cook a lot faster than a bell pepper or an onion, right? So the garlic we wanted to add just to flavor the dish, but everything else we added in stages just because of the cooking time. We want everything to have a balanced texture when we begin to eat it or take a bite of it. So that's why we stage it when we're cooking it.
Chef, someone just asked, should they add wine to the corn or should they just pour it in their glass?
Hey, you talking my language now. Yeah. Listen, if you like wine, white wine, not red wine, right? White wine, you can add just a little bit to it. Don't add too much, right? Because you don't want it to be too loose. So talking my language right there. Now, listen, Louisiana and booze, or New Orleans and booze. Hey, we're going to go make a drink right now. We come back, we're going to play.
We're highlighted. You're live.
Good. Am I live?
Yeah, you are. Say hi.
Hey, how you doing? my name is Terry Folks. I am a local bartender, and I am in partnership with the Listen Through a program that I started called Turning Tables. Liberty's Kitchen has been a great partner in all the ways, including tonight. This was a collaboration between all of us to speak to something that we should be speaking to a long time ago, which is we have here like a black bartender. a Black musician who was featured, a Black chef who was amazing, Alfred Singleton. I mean, so like this was kind of one of the first forays to turn tables and stuff like that. We were like a garden table dinner. So it's been great to circle back in that respect. And now I'm in Munch Factory, which is a Black-owned business that everyone is 100% support. I'm in their Lower Guard District location, and eventually, or now, primarily, they're in Gentilly, and they have a huge pivot coming up. Super excited for it and for them. I'm super excited for partnerships with them in the future. But before I get into turning tables, in your packets, you have some peppers, you have some tahini, you have some lead, and you have some smoked paprika. So what I would suggest is, I've done a lot of the hard labor for you, but I would say if you get a plate like this, put your tahini on this plate. If you're familiar with quartering your lemon, you just basically cut your lemon in half and slice it, and then quarter it, and then that's what you want the plate for as well. You also want, in addition, your smoked paprika, you just want to put that, have ready to go, like, at your fingertips.
So both packets are on the plate?
Yes.
Together?
No, not together. Not together. Just to be clear, the only thing that should be on the plate is the smoked tahini. Smoked paprika is something that you're just going to literally, like, grab from the packet. It'll be more accessible if you just put it on another plate that's accessible to you. I'm not going to assume that in your house that you have all the bar tools that I have, but a to-go coffee cup with a lid, or even your mason jar, your drink can, will suffice. And I'll tell you how to work with that. So before I get into that, turning tables, as I said, is a partnership with Liberty's Kitchen. Through former development director or former development personnel, Harry Schner, and also a local Black chef, Martha Wiggins. And we all came to the point where we were like, you know, how can we make this all more equitable? How can we bring people to the industry where they have support and they have like a creative way to do things in a more meaningful and impactful way? And so turning tables, from my mind, is a 12-week program where each week is focused on spirit, it's focused on a facet of the industry in some capacity, whether it's spirits or wine or beer. And it's not me teaching it primarily, which is, you know, getting people, ambassadors, local breweries to come in and teach. Everyone that's a part of this community comes in and teaches. And then as well, they have mentors throughout this whole process. So each person has a mentor throughout this whole process, as well as they are placed in restaurants where they, or bars, ideally they're placed with their mentors. I think ideally this is the model for what we should do for restaurants. It's like everyone should come into a situation where they're not given an equal like playing field, and they have support, they have the education, and then what can you as a restaurant say? If they have all those things in front of them, that's turning tables. And furthermore, dynamic programming in terms of events, the way that we do things. This, like I said, this was a collaboration. Just one of the ideas that we had in mind. So your drink. So I stopped talking. So this is a drink that I, like I said, I made all the work easier for you. Tequila, Espolón tequila. Tequila, for your information, is made from blue agave, and it is from Jalisco, and it has the same AOC designation as, like, say, like champagne. So you can only make tequila in Mexico, specifically in that region. And what I did was I took the tequila, and, you know, equal parts, four ounces of the tequila that is in your glass to one corn husk, and I blended it together. to give it like a sweet flavor. The reason I did that is to speak to the flavors of Chef Alfred. There's a sweet corn aspect to it. I wanted to go with like Mexican street corn as a flavor for my Alfred. So in your tequila right there, it is tequila blended with corn. Also, there's also some spices that are featured. This is Serrano pepper that I made with a demerara syrup. Demerara syrup is 2-to-1 syrup. What I mean by that is it's 2 parts sugar to 1 part water, and then I blended all of the peppers together. In this case, about 5 peppers were blended together, and then you let it go to a simmer, so it gives us a nice, perfect flavor, and then lemon juice. So, without further ado, let's get this content right here. For your purposes, like I said, it's quite easy. The work is done for you. But I'm going to show you how I would make it if I was in a bar serving you as a bartender. So, sweet corn tequila syrup. It's about 2 ounces. Then, after that, you take 0.5 ounces of this spiced demerara that's going to go, and then 0.25 of this other. So to break that information down, if you don't have any kind of like jiggers or anything in your house, you have a shot glass, for instance, a shot glass typically is about 1.5 ounces of liquid. So you could like maybe like 1 ounce of that from the top to that point, and then like half of that is 0.5 ounces. That's eyeballing at that point. That's like some nerdiness on this point. Content in glass. So at home, what you're gonna do is if you have said coffee thing that I speak of or anything of that nature, or you have your mason jar, pour out half of the contents of your mason jar into something, and then pour ice into that. So you're with me, right? All right, I'm gonna wait.
No. All
right, so then shake it. Light shake, right? Then, you take that lemon that I spoke of, the reason you're on was in, you kind of take it around the rim, right? And then that plate of tahine, take that.
Oh my God.
So lay the rim on your glass, choice looks like that. And then like, you don't have to be fancy about it, you just like, oh, quickly, let's just dump it in there. That's how you do it, right? And then, you take your pepper. So, not everything's perfect. I don't think you have the same peppers I have. I have a Serrano pepper, you have Poblanos, I believe. So, the equivalent of that is you want to take this to something that is about that size. So, I cut it to a point where you could kind of slice it, put it on a glass, rim it. And what you want to have happen in this respect is you want to smoke it. So take that pepper, and then you just kind of give it a little smoke. This is slider collaborator with me. Okay, there we go. Boom, there you go. Give a little smoke to your lighter.
Touré, why are you lighting it? What's that effect for?
Why do you light it on fire?
Why? Because you want the essence of it to come as part of the drink. You want that smoke, you want that flavor. Like I said, the inspiration was Mexican street corn, but also a lot of the flavors of chef. There's like cheese, there's local Louisiana peppers, there's sweet corn in it. Cheese would not translate well into a cocktail that like would open overnight. So there's a little bit of that flavor, and I think like the sweet corn aspect of it's gonna give it some creaminess. But then this will give it a little bit of the like smokiness and the flavor. that you want when you like put it on a drink and you smell it and you get it right off the bat. And then the tahini is a little bit of a flavor profile that you want when you like put it in your face and in your mouth, right? So your drink may not look like this, but like, you know, overall, you know, like kind of something like this. You're getting some creamy corn, you're getting like a little spice, dim in there with the flavor profile of this, like smokiness from this pepper that's coming across. And then you drink it with the pepper facing you, see what that's about. That's like, I'm gonna give you some time. Oh, okay. All right, yeah. So, yeah, I mean, I don't know what's in your glass, but. I mean, that's what's up, you know? So every element of it, like I said, the spice dim, the citrus brightens it up a little bit. You know, spice speaks to chef's flavor profile, and like all of those elements add to the drink.
Lauren's giving you a dance, a happy dance.
So it's all good stuff. I wish there was a way for me to give you the sweet corn tequila by yourself. But like I said, I gave you a template for it, how to make it yourself at your house, which is like, you see one corn husk, 4 ounces of tequila, put it in a blender, put it through like a pasta strainer. You don't need to be fancy or like a treat. Like a pasta strainer is perfect. That product is gonna give you the tequila that like I just gave you, and it's perfect. And that's like specifically how I teach my students how to be creative is like, this cocktail is not original. It's in the Daisy family. By Daisy, I mean, you know, the most popular Daisy, you may have heard of a margarita. So, you know, the profile of a margarita being spirits, citrus, and citrus in the form of bitter, sweet, which is sugar. So that's how they learn the template of things. It's just like from a core of, you know, spirit, citrus, sweet, or spirit, bitter, sweet. Bitter being this citrus that's in the cocktail. So once they learn that, that's how they get creative with their cocktails, and they learn their taste profiles and how to pair things with food. And that's kind of like a way that I try to distinguish it from a normal cocktail program, is that we try to, you know, pair things with chefs. We try to have things that like are more interactive, and you know, the next time around, you're not gonna see me for a while. Because the next time Sketch Chef Night happens, it's gonna be someone from Turning Tables. This platform is theirs. It's not about me. It's about them. It's about New Orleans. It's about giving them a platform. It's about giving them accessibility, entry points into this industry. And like, I am useless in that. Aside from what I do, and I think that we need to give people a platform. So I think like this is a great example of how they can teach you, any one of them can teach you how to do this. And that's what Turning Tables is. If there's dynamic events that are happening over the next few weeks, follow us on Turning Tables NOLA, the website's about to go up. There's so many ways that you can support us, and there's so many dynamic human beings in that realm. I love every single one of them in my heart, their family. That's what we were going for. It's family, from their mentors to the students that were involved. You know, it's above cocktails, above the hospitality industry. It's about what we should have been doing from day one, which is giving people and equal playing from jump, and being dynamic about it, being like creative about it, and teaching them different ways they can do things, having the support from this whole restaurant industry. That's not hard at all.
All right, y'all, we about to take it back to Chef so we can plate those steaks and get y'all eating.
Opportunity to...
Can you repeat?
I'm sorry. Thank you, Touré, for that beautiful cocktail. I just had an opportunity to taste a little bit of that, and I think that's going to be awesome with this dish. Without further ado, let's do what we do. All right. First thing we want to do, ladies and gentlemen, is we want to slice the steak. You can leave the steak whole if you would prefer, but I like to slice it just so there's not a lot of work to it. So I'm just going to take one of these steaks that we have resting, okay? and then take a knife of your choice, and we're just gonna cut it kind of like on a bias, right? Just like such. Notice, if once you look into the steak, you're gonna see that it's the consistency in the color is throughout the steak, right? There's no, it's red right here and gray right there. It's all gonna be the same color throughout the steak, okay? So how big or how small you like it to be, you can plate that. We're gonna do two of these, but I'm gonna just do one right now and just to show you how this plate's gonna look, right? So here comes the beauty of it. The beauty of it. Everybody should have your goat cheese prepared. You should have your mushrooms ready. You should have your corn mock shoe prepared and ready. And I'm gonna grab the plate that we're gonna serve this on. I'm using a vessel that has just a little bit of an edge on it because we're using corn mock shoe. And it has some cream in it. If you're using a flat plate, that might run all over the place. So this is going to keep everything in place inside of this vessel. But you can use whatever you have available. Also, I forgot to mention, if you don't prefer steak, this works well with chicken, beef, pork, veal, lamb, whatever you prefer, whatever protein you prefer. Fish will be great with this dish as well. Whatever you prefer, you can substitute the beef for that and just follow the exact same ingredients. Lobster. You were going to put some crawfish inside of this mock shoe. It would be great as well. All right. So what I like to do is I like to build my plates up, right? So give it a little bit of height to make it look very, very pretty. All right. So when we're serving, always you want to start at the center of the plate, okay? Center of the plate. I don't know how much you eat, but So we got that in my shoe. Now I'm going to take the steak right there. We just finished fanning out, and you can see that beautiful color inside of that steak. Nice medium rare steak. And I'm going to take that steak, and I'm just going to put that right on top of this mock shoe and just kind of fan that off just a little bit, as you can see. That looks beautiful. Oh, yeah, man. Oh, we ready now. We're getting there. Those mushrooms that we had, those oyster mushrooms that we those cremini mushrooms that we had. I'm gonna take a few of those mushrooms, and I'm using a spoon. In restaurants, we always use spoons when we're cooking. And notice that nice creamy consistency and texture that I have on these mushrooms. And I'm gonna take just a little bit of those mushrooms and sit those right on top of that. All right? Beautiful, beautiful mushrooms. Oh, this is beautiful. This is wonderful. Okay? At this point, if you're ready, you can stop and eat. But me, personally, I like to make them a little bit more prettier, right? We have crumbled goat cheese. Goat cheese is very, very creamy, nice, sweet flavor to the goat cheese that I really, really like. That's gonna be great on this dish, okay? So we're gonna take this goat cheese, and I just wanna crumble just a little bit of that goat cheese right over the steak. You don't have to use too much, just use a little bit. As much or as little as you like, okay? Crumble that goat cheese. That's looking beautiful already. Huh? Well, I like goat cheese. Goat cheese works extremely well with mushrooms. First of all, it works real, real great with steaks. If you don't prefer goat cheese, blue cheese works extremely well with steaks. A lot of people prefer blue cheese with steaks, but for this dish that we're building, I prefer to use goat cheese, okay? So what I have here is you should have some green onions in your basket. You didn't have to do this, but I just did it just to make it a little bit pretty. I just cut them up and just nice little strips and put them in a little bit of ice water to let them curl up just a little bit. And I'm just gonna take a few of those and I'm gonna put that right on top of that, right on top of those mushrooms. Get that just a little bit of color, plate contrast, and then just a little bit of parsley, just like such. How Emerald wanna do it? Bang, 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 bang. Nah, we ain't gonna do that. That's Emerald thing, right? So we're gonna add a little bit of parsley to it. And then if you like, a little bit of those Creole spices. And just go across the top and just like such, just to kind of get that a little bit of color on the plate. Ladies and gentlemen, it's time to eat.
So Chef, tell me what's that little funny little herb down there? What's that?
Right there. This is the flower. You can put that on the plate. If you have that, that'll be good on the plate as well. How you like that? So if you got your garlic that came today. This is the flower or the bud from the garlic. Garlic fresh comes on a huge stem with these buds on top of them, and then the clove of garlic or the bushel of garlic is on the bottom of that plate. So, not the plate, the bushel of the bottom, the root part is what we use in a food. All right. So this is just a flour off the top, and it's a great runner. That's a little bit too much. I'm gonna take it off. But it's you know, you can use it as a garnish, or you can just discard it or whatever you like to do. But here we are. I hope you're. Let me see yours. Everybody's look like this.
I was just about to say I want to see everybody place. I want to see how they did. Oh, Ian, beautiful. Oh, look at that. Oh,
yeah.
All right. Look like you done taught them something, Chef. That
hey.
Look, hey. You might need some of them in the kitchen. You might need some in the kitchen with you.
I like it. I'm gonna go ahead and cut this next one, this last one up, and just plate it up. Yes, Syrena, I want to thank you for all of your help today. Thank you for being awesome and.
Nah, you made my job easy, Chef.
Huh?
You made my job easy. Thank you.
Yeah.
I got people in the comments saying you need your own show. Gorgeous, beautiful plates. Thank you, Chef. Yeah.
Well, thank you. Well, we're working on that. We're working on that. Look how beautiful that is on the inside. Oh my God, look at that. I'll tell you, let that rest. Look at the inside of that. That's nice. The color on those steaks, not too cooked. And those mushrooms that we got, beautiful mushrooms. We'll make it all look the same.
Oh, we getting good accolades. Good accolades from everyone. So right before when Chef is done, we're going straight back to T-Ray with a closeout. But thank you guys so much for tuning in with us. This was awesome. Your questions were great. Everybody's plates look spectacular. So that means that's a good credit to Chef because he did his thing. He was very informative, step by step.
Wait, Syrena, before you go, Syrena, we want to know when you're doing your guest chef.
Uh-oh. I know Michelle did that. So very soon. I'm overdue for one. Y'all got to tell me in the chat stream what y'all want me to do. Cause yeah, y'all let me know before I have to come up with it. This drink is beautiful, by the way, and awesome.
All right, so now we want to go back to T-Ray. One more song to close us out. Thank you all so much.
Sometimes it's soft as a mystery.